department. I've been helped refer by to a very fascinating book called The Showman and the Slave. The Showman and the Slave. It's about Ishmael Reed. He's attracted a lot of money by exhibiting a woman claiming she was George Washington's nurse. This African-American woman, she was, you know, she nursed George Washington. And that she's 160 years old. So, when she died, all the Americans were fascinated by her being cut up, like her autopsy. And he took this show on the road. And that was one of the first features of the modern mass published newspaper, 1834, 1835, The Herald. This guy, used that. That was the O.J. Simpson. Everybody thought the O.J. Simpson thing would go away after, you know, the whole white jury, you know, framed him and the strategy that happened in L.A. They tried to get him in Florida. They tried to get him for 16 years for a traffic encounter. They wanted to sentence him. So they finally got him. But that was the O.J. thing of the time. Everybody's fascinated about this woman who says she's 161 years old. We all were waiting for the autopsy. So the modern newspaper, the mass, before that people had to pay 6 cents for newspapers. And only the wealthy could afford it, you know. And it's all long and special interests. But then this guy had the idea of starting a newspaper for a penny. And so the mass people were able to buy it. So you can see where a show business, from the very beginning, influenced the American newspaper. So they are influenced by the circus, and they get hoaxes and stunts.
Yeah.
Like this thing about Judith Miller saying that Savannah had weapons of mass destruction. That's like a big hoax, okay? Or that, I can name other parallels. And so, you know, these are hoaxes that are perpetrated all the time.
But a lot of these hoaxes are generated first with members of the academy who have been given fellowships in places like the Hoover Institute or the Manhattan Institute.
Well, William Simon had the bright idea that he's going to start a counter revolution in the intellectual world. And he got off in the parallels with the rise of Ronald Reagan. And they decided they were going to combat what they considered the liberal domination of American campuses, rather than counter thing with conservatives' money. And the idea that, you know, there are all these radicals with tenure, which is foolish. I mean, that's a hoax. Mm-hmm. I taught at the university. I mean, if anybody should be a radical, I'd be glad to see them in these universities.
Yeah.
If you look at their catalogs, go look at the catalog, if you think of Tony Morrison as appointed Shakespeare, you'll see Europe is still a Eurocentric thing. But he had the idea of marshaling a counter-revolution against him. And I think the Sousa was on it, the domestic Sousa.
Right.
This guy together with this mercenary, he went to a mercenary as well here, this African-Americans. He joined him. And so they built this network of think tanks that would push a lot of, myths and superstitions about the African-American community. That was one of their goals. The other was to get from that war.
Right.
In Iraq. But African-American intellectuals have not found an answer to this.
Mm-hmm.
They did not find an answer to this build-up and this propaganda.
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, some of them are part of it. A lot of stuff, a lot of them Howard,
Shelby Steele,
Yale, I call them this year intellectual. That's probably a little extreme. But you know, Bishop regime supported the Nazi plans, and she knows who was one of these people who contributed to the Bishop publications. Surprise.
Mm-hmm.
You know. So they have had a lot of money, and what they've done is they've hired intellectuals like Sheldon Steele. Or Sheldon Steele gets a lot of space. They're able to afford these people get a lot of network space. They write about that Manhattan is too severe to get out bells. A lot of media coverage.
Right.
So Sheldon Steele got $200,000 from the Bradley Foundation last year.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if anybody's noticed that. I noticed it because that's the guy sitting in the big government after two. He said, after each other, sits on top of each other. But also get my information from other places.
Yeah.
$200,000 from the Bradley Foundation. The Bradley Foundation has been in eugenics. Mm-hmm. The idea that African Americans inferior intellectually.
Mm-hmm.
They're the ones to find Charles Murray, who's the bell curve. And Manhattan Institute was supporting Charles Murray also. And so here's Chevy Steele accepting money from a organization that believes in African American security.
Right.
John McWhorter. John McWhorter got upset with me at Berkeley. We were on the campus at the same time. Because Ashley had already spoken, I said, yeah, I read it in 5 minutes twice. putting the same ideas as Shelby Steele. They love this guy so much, they brought him all the way to New York, where he's now a fellow of the Manhattan Institute. I debated him on Michael Jackson's show, Michael Jackson's show. He wasn't even aware of the history of Manhattan Institute. He wasn't aware that it was founded by Casey.
CIA.
CIA, who might have gone to jail over a man, country had not died. Lieutenant Quack connected to it. He wasn't even aware of that. He said, look, this was made profound. So I called him a black front man for the eugenics movement. And that's why they arranged for a debate between the two of us. So he's there. Proposition 209 was backed by neo-Nazis. I don't know if anybody knows that. I mean, why do you think that it took Warren County so long to reveal the list of contributors? I don't think he ever did.
Not completely, no.
But the Pioneer Fund gave him $35,000 and they supported Hitler. So, if you think somebody's nuts when they say that, you can go to places like Media Transparency. You go to MediaTransparency.com and you'll find the adorners for all these groups that front these things like people out there.
Yeah,